One of the things that intrigued me about this story is that we go back to what I think the audience most enjoys about John Kramer's character, which is that he's philosophical and has a strong moral compass, but also lives in total contradiction to what you would think that compass would be. We know from Saw II that he really only became the Jigsaw after he was diagnosed with cancer and lost his son and all that sort of thing. We know that he's pretty much infallible, and he's often said, if you can anticipate the human mind, it leaves nothing to chance. So we've seen a kind of very rigid formulation of that notion of his character in all the Saw movies. What I really liked about this one is that we go deep in all those things, but we also do things that I think are very unexpected. I think Tobin was really impressed by how much this story truly immerses itself in his character, in his emotional journey. And, you know, it's almost as though the creators realized that it was a big mistake to make a Saw film with no John Kramer and no Tobin in it whatsoever. And so this is almost like a counter reaction to that by let's go all in with Tobin. And so, of course, as an actor, he saw this, I'm sure, as kind of his life's great work. Artistically speaking, I mean, this is his biggest movie by far. So that had to really impress him and intrigue him. He's always sort of the gatekeeper of being true to this kind of enigma that is the John Kramer character, that he doesn't get revenge, he doesn't kill, even though kind of looks like he does, but still, we don't talk in those terms. They're not traps, they're tests. They're, you know, disciples and subjects and this sort of thing. So he always makes sure that we're very careful about those aspects of the story. He really likes John's philosophical side and his use of metaphor, which I think we did a good job with in this film. The Cecilia character is meant to be a very smart, persuasive scientist from Norway, and somebody who, again, to go back to this idea that we really wanted it to feel ironclad, that John Kramer is justified in falling for the scam. She's somebody that I think anybody would trust. She has beauty, she has warmth, and just there's a truthfulness to her. And so we really needed to find that in the actress who plays her. And there were other people that we'd considered beforehand, but none of them quite had that. And she needed to be at least Scandinavian, if not Norwegian. So I was watching this TV show, Ragnarok, on Netflix. That's a Norwegian show. And she's on, and I'm like, that person is really good. And so we reached out to her, and it worked out really well. And I gotta say, like, being around Synnøve Lund is like being around one of the Norse goddesses. The script for Saw X was originally written to take place in Prague, with the idea being that we would shoot in Bulgaria. And for reasons not entirely creative, it was suggested that we go to Mexico. And as soon as I heard that, I said, money aside, I think that would be the very best place we could possibly shoot and set this story, because it's so unexpected, and there's so much sort of strange history to Mexico City with the Aztecs and Cortez and all that, and just the fact that it is such a crazy place. I really thought, not only do we shoot there, but we set it there, and we say that this is where we're setting it. And you know, I think it was a fantastic choice, and I can't even imagine any other version of this story with non-Mexican actors and setting. I wanted these traps to work more mechanically in real life than we've ever done before. We've had to, frankly, use a lot of editing trickery and digital visual effects in order to overcome the shortcomings that we had on production. So for this one, I'm like, let's really make what we're gonna shoot and make it work on screen. So our production designer, Anthony Stabley, who is one of the most enthusiastic people I've ever met in my life, he absolutely was for that, and he sought out a team among the crew members in Mexico City that could really pull it off. And that's not to say that everything worked perfectly, because it didn't. And as is often the case, there are a lot of wires and people hidden in things that are operating things. One of the most complicated parts of this production, and one that we almost died on, was prosthetics. And finding a prosthetics team that could take the actors that we'd cast or were about to cast, and then form the parts of their bodies using artificial materials, and getting it onto the set and operating it on the day when we needed it, and have things go right, and if possible, give us second chances, which often wasn't possible. But we really had trouble at first, and the production stumbled a bit because it turns out that we needed some of these actors 6 weeks in advance in order for them to be cast, and then for the parts to be prepared, and then for us to be able to rehearse with the parts before we actually shot. Saw 6, the first one that I directed, was the last one to be shot on 35mm film, and I'm really glad that it was, even though it's hard to shoot on film. It's a lot more stressful than digital, but there is great value in the texture that you get from film. And once we did Saw 3D, which was shot at 2K res on a digital camera, we started to lose something, and then the subsequent Saw films were also digital, and maybe there was a little bit of filmish grain added afterward, but frankly not a lot in those films. When I met Nick Matthews, the cinematographer and first camera operator for this movie, we both agreed that there was something lost after Saw 6, and that we wanted to bring it back. And even though we shot on digital, we lit it in a way that we thought emulated the look of the earlier films, and also we dirtied it up a bit in post-production.